हाँ यस मैम.
इज ऑडिबल.
ओके सर. सो आई विल बी टेकिंग यू थ्रू द सिलेबस कंटेंट्स ऑफ डिजिटल स्विचिंग सिस्टम्स. सो हैविंग द कोड 17EC654. सो टुडेज क्लास आई विल बी कवरिंग थ्री मॉड्यूल्स. सो द फर्स्ट मॉड्यूल विल बी टॉकिंग ऑन द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ टेलीकम्युनिकेशन एंड द सेकेंड मॉड्यूल विल बी ऑन द एवोल्यूशन ऑफ द टेलीकम्युनिकेशन and the third unit will be on the telecommunication traffic measurements. So as we scroll through the PPTs, so I'll be explaining you. So if any doubts, you please mark it on the chat board. So later on, I can take up the questions. So the main objectives of this digital switching system is to equip the students with the skills and knowledge of the current and future telecommunication network. So assuming that the students have got some basic knowledge on communication systems, computer communication networks. So the main books of reference are like Telecommunication Switching Traffic Networks by J.E. Flood and Digital Switching Systems by Syed R. Ali. You can also refer to Digital Telephony by Bellamy. So coming to the development or a brief history about the telecommunication. So in 1800s, the first basic mode of communication was invented by as telegraph by Wheatstone and Morse. And later on, the basic telephony was invented by Alexander Graham Bell in 1876. So the complete digital switching system can be very well understood by taking a simple example or an application of a telephony. So by the end of 2011 or by 2018, there are more than 10 billion people who are online and using the telecommunication applications. So who all are getting benefited with this telecommunication? So it involves various participants. So the public telecommunication operators, the providers of the services that involve the telecommunication, manufacturers of the equipment and components, so which include both the hardware and software, financial investors, governments, and the last are the users, so who we are responsible to pay the charges to cover the cost of providing the network. So they are referred, so we are referred as the subscribers or the customers. So to establish a telephony or a telecommunication link, so we require two-way communication. So which is on demand and requires a pair of station for communicating between the two end users. So it is a full duplex. So which means that there is a two-way communication carried on simultaneously. So how do we connect the two users over a given entity or an area? So there are various network structures which could be very well used as an application of telecommunication. So the basic network structure is a ring network. So where, as shown in the figure, there are five users who are connected in a loop, and the maximum simultaneous calls that could be connected through the ring network is limited to one. The next one is a bus network. So it is an open loop system where each user is connected to the other user, but the last user will not be back connected to the first user. So this is also which has got a limitation of just getting connected to one call or a one connection at a given instant of time. So the next improved version is a mesh network. So where each and every user is interconnected to the other, and the maximum number of connections that could be realized in a given instant of time will be n into n minus 1 divided by 2, where n is the number of users. So the only drawback with a mesh network is that the number of lines that are required to have a full connectivity between the users. So thereby, knowing the drawbacks and the disadvantages of ring network as well as the mesh network, they came out with an advanced and more feasible solution, that is a star network. So in star network, as shown in the figure, we have a central controlling system, so which is called as an hub, and all the users are connected to this hub. So any user at a given instant of time can get connected to any other user. So the maximum number of simultaneous connections that can be realized using a star network is limited to n. So where n is a number of users that are being connected in the star network. So the last one is a tree network, so which is a combination of both the star as well as the mesh. As shown in the figure, we have two levels of hubs shown. So one is a primary hub, so where all the users are directly connected to the hubs in a star network, whereas the hubs are back connected to the secondary hub again in a star network. So this is the architecture of the tree network, which is being used for long distance communications. So the next one is, how do we connect the people in a given area? So there can be two ways of getting the people connected to the given exchange or a hub or a switching system. So the first figure shows that where we have a single large exchange to which all the users in the area are getting connected. So in the second situation or a case, we see that the entire area is broken up into small sized areas known as a satellite areas, and each satellite area has got a satellite exchange, and the customers or the subscribers in and around these satellite areas are being connected to these satellite exchanges. So either way, we can get the people connected. In the second case, the several exchanges which are being used in a given area are again interconnected by a mesh network to have a realization of a full connectivity of the subscribers. So coming to the telecommunication network hierarchy, so basically the networks can be divided or classified into three networks. One is a local network, junction network, and the trunk network. So what do you mean by local network? So a local network is a network which connects the customers directly to the local exchanges. So these customers are called as a subscribers, and these local networks are also referred to as subscriber distribution networks. So it is also called as a customer loop. So the second type of network is a junction network. So these junction networks interconnects a group of local exchanges serving as an area, and which is also sometimes referred to as tandem exchange or trunk exchange. So the last one is a tall network or a trunk network, which provides a long distance circuits between the local areas throughout the country. So this diagram shows the national telecommunication network. So where we have the various levels of network classification. So at the base of the diagram, we see that there are customer lines to which the subscribers will be connected, and these customer lines will be connected to the local exchanges. So the local exchanges thereby route the call through the local tandem exchanges, then through the regional tandem exchanges, national tandem exchanges, and finally the international gateway exchanges. So these exchanges can be further classified based on the network classification as a local network or a core network or an international network. So the calls based on how they are being connected through this national telecommunication network can be classified as either directly routed calls or indirectly routed calls. So the directly routed calls are those calls which are being directly connected through the exchanges across the same level, whereas the indirect calls are the calls which are being routed through a higher level of exchanges to get connected. So in that case, what happens is that due to the non-availability of the exchanges at the same level, they go in search for a higher level of exchanges. So similarly, we also have an international gateway exchanges. So where the call can get routed through either the satellite links or the submarine cables for an intercontinental or intercountry communication purposes. So next, talking about the elements of the telecommunication network. So the basic elements of a telecommunication network constitutes three subsystems. One is a transmission subsystem, switching subsystem, and signaling subsystem. So the transmission subsystem, so where we have a customer line, where each subscriber line within a localized area is connected to a local exchange by a dedicated circuit. So these lines are also called as digital subscriber lines. So wherein we can use the ISDN or digital transmission can be extended over these subscriber lines. So the next subsystem is a switching subsystem, which is also called as an exchange. So each local exchange within a local area has sufficient switching capacity to support a defined number of simultaneous calls or the connections. So the third one is a signaling system, so which is responsible for interchange of information. So over the various sub entities of the entire call progress, you need to have some signaling to understand the call connection completely. So prior to call taking place, a connection through the network between the two subscribers must be set up. So on completion of a call, the connection has to be closed down. So for these indications, we need some signaling messages. The setting up and the closure of the connections is carried out by the transfer of a defined set of control messages. So these entire switching subsystems will have the various points of interest, so which can be classified as customer nodes, switching nodes, transmission nodes, and service nodes. So talking about the network services, so the customers of public telephony office may require different services which appear to require different networks. So the examples could be a simple PSTN, that is a public switch telephony network, the public switch telegraph network, which is also called as Telex, private networks for voice and data, radio networks providing mobile communication, public data networks, and special service networks. So all these network services share the common transmission bearer network. So as shown in the figure, so the services that are provided over telecommunication network can be divided into two categories. One is tele services and the other one is the bearer services. So these tele services basically depend on the particular terminal apparatus that is available at the subscriber end. For example, a telephony can be supported with a teleprinter or a fax machine. So where the services can be extended depending on the terminals or the equipments that are provided at the subscriber end. So the next one is a bearer service, so which presents the customer with the transmission capacity that can be used for any desired functions. So it could also mean that the various rates at which the data can be transmitted over a given telecommunication network. So a good example is a private circuit. So these are the various terminologies that are being referred both in North America as well as in Britain. So coming to the telecommunication standards, so the entire telecommunication standards fall under the International Telecommunication Union, that is known as ITU, which was founded in 1865 and brought about a standardization of telecommunication services. The work of ITU is carried out under two main bodies. One is ITUT, that is for telecom sector, and ITUR, that is for radio communication sector. So what does this ITUT standard form for? So it is also formally called as Committee Consultant for Telegraph and Telephone, so which is referred to as CCITT, and its main duties include the study of technical questions related to operating methods, tariffs for telephony, telegraphy, and data communication. So the next one is ITUR standard, so which is also called as Committee Consultant for International Radio Communications, that is CCIR. The main properties or the duties include the study of technical questions related to radio communications, including point-to-point communication, mobile services, and broadcasting. So along with this ITUR, we have one more, that is International Frequency Registration Board, which regulates the assignment of the radio frequency to prevent the interference between different transmissions. So coming to the actual communication or the practical communication between the two end users, so we require or we make use of a four-wire circuit. So this four-wire circuit, as the name says, two wires are being connected to each end users. So totally we have two pair wires, so which are making a full connectivity between the end users or the destination and the source. So as shown in this figure, we have the hybrid coils or the balancing network, so which is also called as a four wire circuit. So where on both the sides we have the balancing networks, the users will be connected, and you have a send path as well as a receive path. So on the send path, we have a sending amplifier, then a transmission system, so it could be any media or a cable, then a receiving equipment. So thereby from the receiving amplifier, we have the destination or the call subscriber getting connected. So simultaneously, when the call subscriber is communicating, his information will be passing in an opposite direction through the similar components such as sending amplifier, then the media, then the receiving amplifier. So the main advantage of this four wire circuit is that you can communicate simultaneously in both the directions. So that is the main advantage compared to the half duplex systems. So the main problem associated with this four wire circuit is that a talker echo as well as the listener echo. So the talker echo is an echo or the signal that is being heard by the speaker. So this echo is mainly due to the signal that is traversing from the transmitter end to the receiver and back towards the speaker end. So that is known as a talker echo, whereas the listener echo, so at the destination or the receiver, he keeps on listening to his voice again and again after certain interval of time. So that is known as a listener echo. So when there is a continuous effect of these echoes, we call it as singing within the given network. So just to avoid the singing or the echo effect, we either use the echo cancellers or echo suppressors. So the main reason for the generation of the echo is the imbalance between the two wire impedance and the hybrid transformer. The hybrid transformer load. So when there is a mismatch, so then we will have a back return loss induced into the circuit, and the signals escape through the amplifiers. Even though the amplifiers are a unidirectional devices, there may be some current induced within this hybrid transformer and get coupled to the other side of the circuit. Coming to the different ways of communicating the signals over a media, there are two ways of combining the signals or multiplexing the signals. One is a frequency division multiplexing, and the other one is the time division multiplexing. So the frequency division multiplexing is wherein we identify the different users as different channels, and each of these channels have got different frequencies being allocated, pre-allocated in a given spectrum. But all these channels make use of the media at the same time. So there is no restrictions with the time. The restriction is with the frequency range over which the each channel is being allocated. So this method of communicating the multiple user information over a common media, we call it as frequency division multiplexing. So it is commonly used with the applications of radio and TV transmission. So therefore, to avoid the interference between the two successive channels, we have the guard bands that are commonly used. So the next method of multiplexing is time division multiplexing. So this happens when the data transmission rate of the media is greater than that of the source, and each signal is allotted a definite amount of time. So these slots are so small that all transmissions appears to be parallel. So unlike with the frequency division multiplexing, all the signals operate at the same time with different frequencies, but in time division multiplexing, all the signals operate with the same frequency but at different time slots. So the frame length is normally 125 microseconds. So whether it is a 24 channel system or a 32-channel system. A 32-channel system is also referred to as a European standard or the European frame structure, and 24-channel system is referred to as a North American frame structure. So this time division multiplexing has got the maximum applications at current with the digital mode of communications. So they are classified as either synchronous time division multiplex signals or asynchronous time division multiplexed signals. So as shown in the diagram, it is very well understood that the time slots are pre-assigned and fixed. So this slot is even given if the source is not ready with the data at that particular time. So in this case, the slot is transmitted empty and it is used for multiplexing the digitized voice stream. So as shown in the figure, there are four terminals A, B, C, D, which are being multiplexed, and within each frame, the allocation for each of these terminals are being fixed. So if the data is there, that will be occupying its corresponding slot. If the data is not there, so that slot will be kept empty. So the next one is the asynchronous or statistical time division multiplexing. The slots are allocated dynamically depending on the speed of the source or their ready state. So this dynamical allocation of the time slots has got an advantage, so where it saves the channel capacity. So coming to the network classification, so we have two types of networks, that is PDH networks and SDH network. So the abbreviation of PDH is that it is a Lisiochronous Digital Hierarchy Network. So it is a popular technology applied in the networks of telecommunication in order to transport the huge amounts of data over digital transport equipment like fiber optic or microwave radio systems. As shown with the figure below, the digital multiplexer inputs are of same bit rate and are derived from different clocks from different oscillators. So each will differ within a tolerance of few clock periods, and hence it is called as Lisiochronous. So the term Lisiochronous is derived from the Greek Lisio, and which means near and close time, and refers to the fact that PDH networks operate in a state where different parts of the network are nearly synchronized, but not quite perfectly synchronized. So that is the main drawback of the PDH networks. So as shown with the example diagram here, so we have a North American channel, that is a 24 channels, which have been multiplexed using a primary multiplexer. So which gives a rate of 1.54 Mbps. So which is referred to as DS1 frame. So later on, such 1.54 Mbps lines in number 4 are multiplexed in the second order of multiplexing, which gives a result of a rate of 6.3 Mbps. So similarly, this 6.3 Mbps, 7 such lines are multiplexed within M23, giving a way to 44.73 Mbps. So in this way, ultimately, the multiplexing, as it goes with a higher hierarchy level, it gives to an higher data rates. So as shown at the end, we see that it can be realized with DS4, where it could be either 274.16 Mbps or 139 Mbps or 564 Mbps, depending on the number of lines that are being multiplexed with the DS4 stage. The next type of hierarchy is the synchronous digital hierarchy network. So commonly this SDH is being supported on optical fibers. So that is why it is normally alternatively referred to as SONETs. So it is a standardized technology that is used for high speed data transmission of telecommunication digital signals. It can transfer multiple digital bit streams synchronously over the optical fiber using lasers or highly coherent light from light emitting diodes. So as shown with the figure, in SDH, the digital multiplexer inputs are of the same bit rate. So where each line has got a bit rate of 155 Mbps and are derived from the common clock. Hence, it is called as synchronous. The SDH system is designed to replace the PDH system for transporting large quantities of telephone calls and data traffic over the same fiber without synchronization problems, providing a simple and flexible network infrastructure. So as shown with the diagram, we have STM1 frame, so which is supporting 155 megabits per second And we have STM4, so it is the next level of multiplexing, so which gives us a data rate of 620 Mbps. And the last one is STM16, so which gives us still higher data rate of 2.4 Gbps. So then what are the advantage of SDH over PDH? So the standardized optical interfaces make it more convenient for interconnection in lines using SDH. The world standard frame structure and the rate of digital signals make it easy to interconnect with the world standards. Then SDH has excellent ability of digital cross-connect. Then SDH is equipped with the powerful capacity of networking and network protection. Synchronous structure is flexible. Then SDH adapts the synchronous mapping, encapsulation, and pointer to facilitate the add and the drop branches. Then it is a cost effective and reduces the networking cost due to the transversal compatibility. So it possesses forward as well as backward compatibility. So these are the advantages. So similarly, the disadvantages make the PDH more important. So the utilization rate of SDH bandwidth is relatively low. So in SDH, about 1/20th of the data frames are used as a signals of management, thus resulting in the reduction of data frames utilized to transmit the signals. So SDH is lacking in network security because of adopting operation, administration, and maintenance, that is OAM, as the monitoring and maintenance instrument of its following performances. As the common software, OAM is likely to be attacked by virus or trojans, owing some bugs of designing and developing it. So that will be about the module one. So the second module speaks about the evolution of the switching systems and the basics of the digital switching system. So in large networks, there might be multiple paths linking sender and receiver. Information may be switched as it travels to the various communication channels. There are three typical switching techniques available for the traffic, digital traffic. So it could be either a circuit switching, message switching, or packet switching. So what do you mean by circuit switching? Circuit switching is a technique that directly connects the sender and the receiver in an unbroken path. So the telephone switching equipment, for example, establishes a path that connects the caller's telephone to the called telephone by making a physical connection. So with this type of switching technique, once the connection is established, a dedicated path exists between both the ends until the connection is being terminated. So the routing decisions must be made when the circuit is first established, but there are no decisions made after that time. So the main advantage is that the communication channel is very much dedicated. So the drawbacks of circuit switching, possibly long way to establish a connection, more expensive than any other switching techniques because of the dedicated path required for each connection, inefficient use of communication channel because the channel is not used when connected systems are not using it. So the second method of switching is called as a message switching. So with message switching, there is no need to establish a dedicated path between the two stations before the communication starts. So when a station sends a message, the destination address is appended to the message. The message is then transmitted through the network in its entirety from node to node. So each node receives the entire message, stores it in its entirety on disk, and then transmits the message to the next node. So this type of network is also referred to as store and forward network. So as shown with this simple example, so where we have different nodes from A to H, and as shown, there are two colors shown. So the message, whatever has to be transmitted from A to H, can either follow the path of message one or the path of message two. So at each node, it is the node's decision to forward the message to the next node. So depending on various parameters, such as the cost or the distance or the latency, the messages will be chosen to pass through the next immediate nodes. The main advantages of the channel, sorry, message switching is that the channel efficiency can be greater compared to the circuit switch system because more devices are sharing the channel. Traffic congestion can be reduced because messages may be temporarily stored in a route. Message priorities can be established due to store and forward technique. Message broadcasting can be achieved with the use of broadcast address appended within the messages. The drawbacks, message switching is not compatible with interactive applications. So for real-time communication, this is not very feasible. Then store and forward devices are expensive because they must have large disks to hold potentially long messages. So the third type is a packet switching, so which is also a type of message switching, can be seen as a solution that tries to combine the advantages of message switching and circuit switching and minimize the disadvantages of both. So there are two methods of packet switching. One is a datagram and virtual circuit. So the entire messages are divided into small packets, and each of these packets will constitute the source address as well as the destination address. So these packets travel through the network in different sequence depending on the various parameters, circumstances, and reach the destination. So when they reach the destination, as shown in the figure, the sequencing may not be there. So it is up to the destination to rearrange the packets in a sequence to get back the original information that is being transmitted from the source. So the examples, so this is just a brief list of the three types of switching. So in circuit switching, a path is established between the caller and the destination. So it is a real-time connection formed. A good example is a public switch telephony network, PSTN. Then message switching, it is also called as store and forward. The message is first stored in a buffer and then sent on its entirety step by step as the resources become available at different levels of the network. So it is not a real-time connection. So it is also called as connectionless. So the good example for this will be the email. Packet switching, a message is broken into parts and each part is sent separately. So a good example can be an internet UDP protocol. So coming to the functions of the switching systems. So a switching system, as I said in the beginning, can be very well understood as a simple telephony exchange. So from the basics, whatever is a type of a switching system, it could be either a manual or electromechanical or electro switching, electronic switching, or a digital switching system, the basic functionalities are same. So the first one is the identification. So the local switching center must react to the calling signal from the calling subscriber and must be able to receive the information to identify the required destination and the terminal sees signal. So that is known as the identification of the calling subscriber. The next one is addressing. The switching system must be able to identify the call subscriber from the input information. So that is very important. So where the call has to be routed is being understood as a second function. So the third one is finding the path setup. So once the calling subscriber destination is identified and the call subscriber is available, an accept signal is passed to the switching system and the calling subscriber. So based on the availability, a suitable path or the interconnections will be made within the exchange to connect the caller with the called subscriber. So next is a busy testing. So if the number dialed by the calling subscriber is either wrong or the call subscriber is busy or the terminal may be free but no response is being received, a switching system has to pass a corresponding voice message or a busy tone after waiting for certain time. So the fifth one is a supervision. So once the path is set up between the calling and the call subscriber, it should be supervised in order to detect the answer and the clear down conditions and record the billing information, so which is very important. So the sixth one is clear down. So when the established call is completed, the path setup should be disconnected. So if the calling subscriber keeps off the phone first, so it is called as clear forward is passed to the switching system. So in the other case, if the call subscriber keeps the phone down first, it is called as clear backward signal, which has to be passed on to the switching system. So by clear signal, the switching system must disconnect the path setup between the calling and the call subscriber. So what all resources have been allocated for that particular call will be returned back to the pool and will be ready to get utilized by some other connections. So the last functionality is the billing. So a switching system should have a mechanism to meter or count the number of units made during the conversation. The cumulative number of units made for a particular duration by the calling subscriber is calculated, and this information should be sent to the calling subscriber. So in the text, it also says about the last functionality, that is about the information sending. Suppose a call is being a trunk call or a tandem call, where the call has to get routed through more exchanges. Then between the exchanges, whatever the basic information is being collected by the local exchange will be transferred to the next level of the exchange for the call to get routed. So that is known as the information sending. So that will be the eighth important function of a switching system. So next, taking up an example of a crossbar switching. So which is the most commonly used technique with the switching system. So it became more popular in 1940s. So where basically they made use of electromechanical devices to realize this crossbar switching concept. So as shown in the diagram, so it has got some incoming lines or incoming circuits and outgoing circuits, which are connected in the format of a matrix. So taking an example of a 3x3 crossbar switch, we have the incoming lines, which are shown by a dark line, that is ABC. And similarly, we have an outgoing lines, which can also be the same thing as the incoming lines, that is ABC. So as shown here, each incoming or a horizontal line is being connected to an electromechanical brush. And similarly, all the outgoing or the vertical lines are also connected to and another electromechanical brush. So both these horizontally placed brush and the vertically placed brush are initially will be away. So they won't be in contact in the initial stages. Depending on the call arrival, these brushes will be either in the closed position or in the open position. So apart from these dark lines, we also see some dotted lines. So where each horizontal line or the wire is being supported by some electromagnets. So you have a rod on which the horizontal brushes as well as the vertical brushes are resting, and these bars are connected to electromagnets. So depending on the call connection, one of these electromagnets horizontally as well as the vertically electromagnet gets energized, and the corresponding cross point brush will come in touch with each other, and that cross point will get looped or they will be latched for the call connection. So taking an example, so there are various methods of establishing the connection. So there are two basic schemes that are used with the crossbar exchangers. So the first scheme explains that first energize for a given any call, energize the horizontal bar first, then energize the vertical bar depending on the called subscriber information, then de-energize the horizontal bar. So this keeps the call intact between the calling subscriber and the called subscriber. So once the call is cleared, immediately the vertical bar is also de-energized, so which indicates the switching system as the call is being cleared from the exchange. So you also have an alternate scheme too, so which is slightly a reverse procedure or a methodology. So where we energize the vertical bar first, energize the horizontal bar, then de-energize the vertical bar till the end of the call, and once the call is being terminated, de-energize the horizontal bar. So either of these schemes are being used with the cross point switching matrices. So these crossbar switch configuration can be realized either as non-blocking schemes or a blocking scheme. So with the non-blocking scheme, a very good example is a diagonal cross point matrix. So as shown in the figure, so where we have four subscribers ABCD being connected to the outgoing lines of ABCD, that is as shown in the diagonal diagram. So here the total number of cross point switches required is reduced, so where it is n into n minus 1 by 2, whereas in case of a full matrix configuration, we require totally n square elements. So the number of elements is very much reduced with such non-blocking schemes. So the number of elements is the same as that of the full connected network. So the connection establishment has got a sequence. So where first energizing the corresponding horizontal bar and then energizing the corresponding vertical bar. So the basic drawbacks with the non-blocking schemes is that, so a large number of switching elements are being employed and difficult to implement in practice, and it is not cost effective. So as a solution, they came up with the design of a blocking crossbar switching systems. So this is a simple example. So where the main aim is to reduce the number of cross point switches. So it could be realized either in a single stage or multi-stage switching networks. So the methodology is that the two subscribers either share one vertical bar or all subscribers share a number of vertical bars. So in the first case, when two subscribers share one vertical bar, the number of bars are reduced and the number of cross point switches remains the same. Whereas when all the subscribers share a number of vertical bars, the number of bars and the cross point switches are very much reduced. So here the blocking configuration can be properly so designed that it can be allowed over a given network. So the next topic is with respect to the electronic switching system. So with the electronic switching system, so where there was an advancement with the technology, so which replaced the electromechanical components of a switching system with the electronic components such as resistors, markers, semiconductors, so which had a longer lifetime and the reliability was higher than the electromechanical switching system. So these electromechanical switching system were prone to wear and tear with the time, and the lubrication was very much needed for the electromechanical systems, and which was completely avoided with the electronic switching systems. So the basic advantages with the electronic switching system includes call barring, repeat the last call, reminder calls, call diversion, three-way calls, and the charge advice. So these were the advancements that were realized using the faster electronic switching systems. So the next one is to learn what are the basics of a digital switching system. So a digital switching system basically can be represented with this simple block diagram, so which shows the basic central office linkages. So we have a central office, which is also referred to as a switching system or an exchange, to which the various facilities or the linkages are shown. So we have a main distributing frame, trunk distributing frame, power plant, carrier facilities, digital cross connect, and special services. So this main distributing frame, or MDF, has got a very important function. So where it has got two sides, one is a vertical side and the other one is the horizontal side. So the vertical side of this MDF will be connected to the subscriber lines, and the horizontal side will be terminated onto the central office. Whereas in the trunk distributing frame, we have the connections that are being done between the exchanges, So which cater their service to the junction networks or the junction circuits. So the vertical side of the TDF will be connected to the incoming trunks, and the horizontal side of the TDF will be connected to the central office. So we have a power plant. So a combination of the power converters, battery systems, and emergency power sources, which supply the basic minus 48 voltages and plus 24 voltage DC power and the protected AC to the central office switch or a group of switches constitutes the power plant. And these should not be confused with the power distributing frames in the central offices that provide the special voltage conversions and protection of the central office. So then we have carrier facilities. So these facilities provide carrier or multiplex transmission mode between the central offices and with other parts of the telephony network. So these facilities typically employ coaxial cables. So digital cross connect is the next linkage. So which provides automatic assignments and cross connection of trunks to the digital switching systems. It can be considered a small switching system for the trunks. So the last linkage is with the special services. So these services which require the special interfaces or procedures to connect the central office facilities to the customers, for example, like data services and wireless services. So coming to the switching system hierarchy, so similar to the national telecommunication network, what we saw under module one, so this is with respect to the digital switching system. So basically the entire network is classified into five different classes. So class five is the basic class, the end office, or which is also referred to as an equivalent local exchange, where the subscriber lines will be terminated. So the next class four and class three indicates the tandem exchanges or the trunk exchanges, and class two represents the sectional exchanges, and class one represents the international gateways. So these are the five classifications under digital switching system. So where the different types of networks are being realized or the exchanges are being ordered. So talking about the evolution of digital switching systems. So with the digital switching system, stored program control switching system or the SPC exchanges were played an important role. So the control of the switching functions was programmed into the memory and the actions were executed by controlling processors. The early versions of the electronic switching systems had temporary memory for storing the transient call information and semi-permanent memories that carried the programming information and could be updated. So as shown with the diagram, so we have a stored program control system connected to various types of controls such as line control, ancillary controls, trunk controls, and the maintenance controls. So coming to the evolution of a digital switching lines, as shown with the first diagram, that is A, we have an analog switch which supports the analog lines as well as analog trunks. So the entire information was in the analog domain, and even the switching system played a role with the analog signals. So the next advancement with this basic configuration is to replace the analog switch with the digital switch. But still the lines and trunks remained analog in nature. So to support the lines with the switch, the requirement of A to D and D to A converters were required and were introduced onto the lines. So the next advancement was to have a digital switch between the two different exchanges. So that is where the digital trunks were introduced between the two digital switches, but still from the subscriber lines as well as between the exchanges, there existed analog trunks as well as lines. So it is a combination of both the case of A and B, so which supported both the analog and analog lines and trunks and digital trunks. So the next advancement was where everything was digitized. So even the signals that were flowing through the lines and the trunks were digitized. And these digital lines and trunks were terminated onto digital switch. And between the switches, there were the connections which was done through digital trunks. So that is where the actual digital system defines the complete digitization of end-to-end connections. So coming to the building blocks of a digital switching system, the development of this DSS is described in four stages. So the first stage looks at very basic kernel of DSS with the switching matrix called as a switching fabric, since not all switching systems use a matrix arrangement of switching. The switching fabric switches lines and trunks under the control of central processor and network controller. The second stage of this development introduces the concepts of line and trunk modules. The third stage introduces the notion of interface controllers and the distributed processing. The fourth stage presents a high-level design of digital switching system equipped with the service circuits. So as shown in this diagram, the first stage where it shows the lines and trunks which are directly terminated onto the switching fabric supported with a network controller. So this switching fabric will be controlled by the central processor through the network controller. So that is a very basic configuration or the development with the DSS. So later on, they try to modularize the given configuration or the design, so where the line modules and the trunk modules were introduced. So each of these modules were truncated with a group of subscriber lines and the trunk modules with a group of trunk lines. So where the complete design became a modular, so if there was any problem with any line, so that particular line module could be easily tracked and could be rectified for that particular correction of the line connections. So which made the job easier and traceable in order to rectify the wrong connections. So the third stage of development of a DSS, so where as observed with the previous diagram and this, we see that we have an IC associated with the switching fabric and the network control processor, which has been separated from the switching fabric. So as shown here, we have the interface controller or IC, which is a part of a switching fabric. So which basically times which the information from the lines and the trunks onto the space switch, which is called as a switching fabric. So the entire interface controller, switching fabric, and an interface controller block is nothing but a TST switch that is being realized with the digital switching system, which has got a very good efficiency. So now coming to the line modules. So these line modules and trunk modules are directly being controlled by the secondary processors, which are also called as network control processors. So this network control processors is very much responsible in deciding which cross point of the switching fabric has to be closed for a particular connection to happen within that switching system. So this network control processor is again being controlled by the central processor. So this, depending on the number of NCPs, the exchanges can be classified as either a small exchange or a large exchange. So this is the fourth stage of development with the switching, digital switching system. So where each line module is being associated with the service circuit. Similarly, a trunk module is also being associated with a service circuit. So apart from that, we also see that a shadowing effect with the NCP and the central processor. So which means that the network control processor and the central processors are being duplicated. So this duplication is introduced just to have the maximum reliability and the connectivity through the network efficiently to happen. So in that case, so even if the current NCP goes under some problem, immediately the backup or the duplicated NCP will take over the connection and the call will be uninterrupted and will be completed through the given exchange. So here, apart from the line modules and IC and the switching fabric, we have a service circuits. So the basic functionality of these service circuits is to give an indication of different stages of development of a call progress. So initially, when there is a call being originated, so it has to indicate a dial tone to the calling subscriber and a ringing tone to the call subscriber, so which is very much being initialized by these service circuits through the line module and the NCP controls. So these are the important things, and this stage four development of DSS serve as a basic design for any DSS. So this is a basic configuration which is used as a reference model to understand the various parameters of a digital switching system. So coming to the classifications of the calls. So basically, we have four types of call classification with the fourth stage of development of DSS. So it could be either intra LM calls, inter LM calls, incoming calls, and outgoing calls. So intra LM calls, so LM means line module. So as the name says, in intra LM calls, both the calling and the call subscriber lines will be terminated onto the same line module. So as shown with the diagram, we have the two telephone parts being connected to the same line module. Okay, so when there is a call arrival from the calling subscriber, the service circuit will understand there is a call initiation. So in turn, the line module will pass the information to the network control processor, so which will analyze the numbers that are being dialed by the calling subscriber and get to know which of the cross point on the switching fabric has to be closed. And that information will be passed on to the interface controller. Through the interface controller, the switching fabric cross point will be activated and will be closed. So once that is closed through the interface controller, again through the line module, the call subscriber will be connected to the calling subscriber. So once the connection is being completed, the service circuit will send a ringing tone towards the call subscriber. So this is how the procedure goes on. And once the call subscriber pickups the call, so the next is that the communication starts between the two subscribers. So once the call is ended, the service circuit will give a beep tone or the clear down tone to the switching or the switching system. So where all the network NCP control and the IC control on the switching fabric will be reset, and the cross point will be made available for any other subscriber to get connected. So this is a basic call that is being progressed to the fourth stage of DSS. So this is when both the subscriber lines are connected to the same line module. So similarly, we have the next classification of the call, which is as shown with the diagram. We have two telephone parts which are being connected to different line modules. So here the incoming line module and the outgoing line modules are different. So these coordination between the line modules will happen through the network control processor as well as the interface controller and the switching fabric. So otherwise everything remains the same. So only the thing is where the subscribers reside in different line modules. So the next one is the incoming call and the outgoing call. So the incoming trunk call is where you have a call received from another exchange and to the current exchange, and the subscriber is residing in this current exchange. So in that case, the call gets routed through the trunk module. So this trunk module will be supported by various signalings that are being provided by the service circuit associated with the trunk module, and call will get understood by the network control processor, that is a secondary processor, and will give the instructions to the TST switch and which line module has to be selected for the called subscriber line. So once that line module is being identified, so that particular line module service circuit will activate the called subscriber and he will be indicated to pick up the call. So that is about the incoming trunk call. So on the similar lines, we have an outgoing trunk call. So where the calling subscriber will be connected to one originating line module, so which will pass on the information to the NCP, giving the details of the destination or the call subscriber. So this analyzing the call subscriber address, the TST switch will be decided which cross point has to be selected to route the call to the next adjacent switching system or the DSS. So the call will be routed to the trunk module, the corresponding trunk module of that particular adjacent or the neighboring trunk exchange, and that will be supported by the service circuit, so which gives an indication to the next neighboring exchange that there is an incoming trunk call. So these are the various functionalities that are being associated within the DSS for different types of basic call classification. So it could be either an intra-LM call or inter-LM call or an outgoing call or an incoming call. That is about the module 2. So the third module describes the telecommunication network. So if anybody is having any questions regarding the modules, you can just post it on the chat box. So the third module is about the telecommunication traffic. So it is a very important subject or a mathematical or statistical analysis of digital switching system. So how do you measure traffic on a given switching system? So the performance analysis methods applied to telephony are usually referred to as traffic engineering. So the basic things, the factors which are being motivated are mainly the unpredictable behavior of the users. That is, we will never know when the call arrives on a switching system, and the users have to share the resources. So these are the two basic factors which makes us feel the importance of measuring the traffic measurement. So the various terminologies. So what is a trunk? So the telephone lines connecting one telephone switch or exchange with another are called as trunks. Then what is calling rate? The number of calls which arrive over a given time interval. So in short, it is the number of calls per unit time is called as a calling rate. Then the holding time. So it is the average duration of a call is called as holding time and is represented by H. So telephone traffic may fluctuate throughout the day and may have a busy hour, which is the hour that has the most number of calls in a given day duration or 24 hours of observation. So busy hour depends on various factors such as stock market, weather, and international events. So this busy hour may vary from day to day and from season to season. So as shown with this simple graph, we see that around 10 to 11, we have a peak traffic that is being observed. So where that 1 hour of duration can be defined as a busy hour with that particular day. So coming to the measurement of the traffic intensity, more oftenly referred as traffic, is defined as the average number of calls in progress. So it is given by a basic equation, very important equation, that is capital A equal to CH by T. So where A defines the traffic intensity, C is the number of calls arrival during the time capital T, and H is the average holding time. So this traffic intensity is measured using the unit called as Erlangs. So how do we define an Erlang? So we'll see to that. So for example, if I take a single trunk which cannot carry more than one call, so we have the traffic intensity always either less than one or equal to one. So similarly, the probability of finding the trunk busy is equal to the proportion of time for which the trunk is busy. So thus, this probability equals the occupancy of the trunk. So an Erlang traffic is nothing but the average holding time of a set of trunks being observed over a given interval of time. So this is where we have three trunks are shown, where the first trunk is being occupied for the throughout the complete period of the time, whereas the second trunk is occupied for half of it, and the third trunk is not at all being occupied. So the total traffic that is being measured is 1.5 Erlangs. So the same 1.5 Erlangs can be distributed in different ways over the trunks. So the first trunk can be occupied only for 1/4 of the time, whereas the second trunk can be occupied for 3/4, and the third trunk can be occupied for half the time of the given observation period. So this is how the traffic intensity is measured over a given set of trunks, and the unit of measurement is Erlangs. So taking few examples to understand the importance of the basic formula of the traffic measurement. So one example, on average during the busy hour, a company makes 120 outgoing calls of average duration 2 minutes and receives 200 incoming calls of average duration 3 minutes. So find the outgoing traffic, the incoming traffic, and the total traffic. So to measure the traffic, we have an important basic formula, that is A equal to CH by T. So as given in the problem, it is during the busy hour, which indicates a duration of 1 hour, that is capital T will be 1 hour or 60 minutes. So the outgoing traffic, which corresponds to the number of outgoing calls, which is 120, and the holding time small h is 2 minutes for the outgoing calls, and the total duration is 1 hour, that is 60 minutes, where the total outgoing traffic will be 4 Erlangs. And similarly, the incoming traffic, which caters to 200 incoming calls of average duration 3 minutes, so which gives an incoming traffic of 10 Erlangs. So the total traffic that is observed over the given company over the time of 1 hour is 14 Erlangs. Similarly, few more examples are being quoted. You can just go through the slides. So coming to the types of calls, so basically the calls can be classified as either lost calls or queuing calls. So first we'll take up the lost call or the blocked calls. So a good example of a lost call is with the circuit switch systems. So here, all the attempts made to make a call over a congested group of trunks are unsuccessful. The unsuccessful call is called as a lost call or a blocked call. So under lost call systems, such as a telephony system, so we have an important parameter of measure known as grade of service. So it is the probability of meeting the blockage and is called as grade of service. So on average, if one call in 100 is blocked, then the grade of service is defined as 1 by 100 or 0.01. So the grade of service is also defined as the proportion of time for which the congestion exists, the probability of congestion, the probability that a call will be lost due to congestion. Traffic A Erlangs is offered by a group of trunks having a grade of service B, the traffic lost will be A into B, and the traffic carried is A into 1 minus B Erlangs. So with this sentence, we need to identify there are three parameters. One is the traffic that is offered, the traffic that is lost, and the traffic that is carried. So the traffic offered is A, the traffic lost is B, and the traffic carried is A into 1 minus B. So these are the three important traffic parameters that we measure to understand the grade of service of a given system, or a lost call system. So taking one simple example, during the busy hour, there are 1,200 calls which were offered to a group of trunks, and 6 calls were lost, and the average call duration was 3 minutes. So here we need to calculate the total duration of periods of congestion. So to calculate that, we need to calculate what is the grade of service. So first we'll calculate what is the traffic offered. So that is the number of incoming calls, that is 1,200 calls of average duration 3 minutes. So which is being observed over a busy hour of 60 minutes. So where the traffic offered is 60 Erlangs, and out of these 1,200 calls, 6 calls were lost, which defines the traffic that is carried, which comes down to 59.7 Erlangs, and the traffic that is lost will be the difference between the traffic offered and the traffic carried, that is 0.3 Erlangs. So the grade of service is given by B by A. So where the traffic lost is defined as capital B, so that is 0.3 by 60, and that is 0.005. So the total duration of periods of congestion is given by B into T, that is 18 seconds. So here the capital T is taken over a busy hour of 60 minutes or 3600 seconds. So this is a simple formula of a traffic measurement where the number of call arrivals in a given time has a Poissonian distribution. So which is given as P of X, which is equal to mu to the power of x by x factorial into e to the power of minus mu. So where mu is the mean number of call arrivals in time t, and x is the number of call arrivals in time t. So using having the data of x and mu, we can calculate the probability of x calls that are arriving at a given instant of time. The call holding time is also modeled by a negative exponential distribution. So these are some of the basic assumptions that are made to define a lost call system or a queuing system. So where the holding time, so the holding time is a duration between a call arrival and the call termination, so which has got a negative exponential distribution. So as given with the formula, the probability of t greater than or equal to t is equal to exponentially minus t by h. So where capital P is the probability of the call lasting longer than t, and h is the mean call duration, and h is, for the example, they have taken it for 3 minutes and they have plotted the graph. So where it is being shown that it is negatively exponential line. So an example explaining the formula. So next, coming to the last call systems. So how do you measure the average traffic or the traffic intensity of a lost call system? So consider a large number of local loops or the subscriber lines that are served by a small number of trunks in an exchange. So let the traffic offered be measured as A Erlangs, and the entire system has got N outgoing trunks. When a call is demanding a trunk line, it arrives, it is assigned a free trunk line if one is available. But if all the trunks are engaged, that call will not be supported and will be lost. And since no provision is there to is there for buffering for the call. So the basic assumptions of a lost call formula are, the first one is a pure chance traffic. So which explains the call arrivals and call terminations are purely a random process. Then full availability. So meaning that any trunk or any line can be connected to any other line, and there is no anything like prioritization or the basic masking of the lines. So it is a full connectivity or a full availability scheme. And the third one is that, so when there is a call, when there is a congestion in the system, whatever the calls that are arriving during the congestion are lost. So there is no option for the call to get stored. So for a lost call system having n number of trunks, when offered with traffic A, the first airline distribution formula is given by the formula, that is P of x equal to a to the power of x by x factorial divided by the summation of a to the power of k by k factorial. So where x is the number of occupied trunks and P of x is the probability of x occupied trunks. So when the number of calls arrivals is same as the number of trunks available on a given system, that particular probability is of very importance, which defines the grade of service of that particular lost call system and is defined as capital B, which is nothing but P of n. So an example is taken to understand the airline's lost call formula. So it is also called as airline B formula. So a group of 5 trunks is offered with 2 airlines of traffic. Find the grade of service. So to find the grade of service, where we need to equate the number of trunks equal to the maximum number of trunks, that is capital N. So having the N value as 5, substituting, we see that the grade of service of the given system is 0.037, and the probability that only one trunk is busy. So out of 5 trunks, if only one call is being supported, then the probability of the call that can be connected will be 0.275. So this is just a simple example which gives an application of the airline's lost call formula. So suppose the other situation, so where there is only one trunk free, saying that the other way, that 4 trunks are busy. So where the probability of measuring the 4 trunks being busy is 0.0917. And the probability that at least one trunk is free, so where the x value is less than 5 and it is nothing but 1 minus b, and that is 0.963. So where 96.3% of the calls can be supported, so that is when only one trunk, at least one trunk is free. So normally this airline B formula or the last call formula is supported by a traffic table. So where we have vertically, we have the number of trunks. So in this picture, we have 24 trunks which are being supported. So we have various grade of services that are being indicated. The first one is 0.001, the second one is 0.02, and the similarly 0.05, and the last one is 0.01. So for different grade of services, the traffic units that are being defined for the calls that are being supported is shown with the table. So we can either use the lost call formula to calculate the traffic or the number of trunks that are being supported for a given grade of service, or we can make use of this traffic table directly. So using the table, so how do we find the incoming traffic or how many exchange lines are required? So that is this problem where you need to calculate the number of trunks that are required to carry the grade of, to provide the given grade of service of a given exchange. So the next type of switching system is the queuing system. So which is having a common applications of queuing, which is being observed in telecommunication, then the sequence of computer operations, then predicting the computer performance. And one of the key modeling techniques for computer systems, networks in general, traffic control, then airport traffic, airline ticket sales, then layout of manufacturing systems, health services. So where example, controlling the hospital bed assignments and etc. So here the model of the queuing system can be shown with a simplified diagram. So where we have a customers standing in the queue and the queue length is predetermined. So ideally we choose the queue length to be infinite and this queue get serviced by the server. So the number of servers make a difference. And as and when the server gives the services, the customers are cleared from the queue. So once the customers are cleared, which gives an option for the new customers to enter the queuing system. So the basic assumptions of the queuing system is similar to the last call system. The first three are same. One is the full availability, statistical equilibrium, pure chance traffic, and the calls or the customers encountering the congestion will enter a queue or a delay system. So when there is a congestion, there is an option for buffering the calls or the customers, those are entering the system. So it is not just like that in the last call system, it is not lost. So it can be stored and can be forwarded when the server is free. So this is a simplified line diagram which explains the queuing system. Yes, this is about the traffic, telecommunication traffic, which has been explained. So if any doubts are there, so you can just put it across the chat box. So where I can try to answer the doubts. Oh, I don't see any doubts.
Thank you, ma'am, for this amazing session. If anyone has any doubts, kindly post it in the chat box.
Okay. So I don't see any doubts.
Yes, ma'am, there are no doubts. So we will end the session here.
Okay, okay. Thank you, madam. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to explain the basic concepts of digital switching system. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am, for this amazing session.
Yeah.
Okay. So we will end the meeting here. Thank you, everyone, for joining.
Yeah, thank you.